We talked about this a while ago, about basically getting some tips out, information about how to go to print, which is so important. You and I talk about it all the time. Why don't we dive in? Let's see what you
got. Yeah, I do have a list. And okay. the list may be slightly outside the bounds of what you might think a list would be. It's kind of, I equate this list to what people equate how to learn photography, and they think things like, got to get the best camera, got to get all that, really has not much to do with learning photography. And I think bookmaking is a little similar. So I kind of want to go out in front what you would be contemplating and thinking about even before you start to go to print, whether you're making a single print or a magazine or a book or anything else. I think these are things that you have to keep in mind. And point number one.
What are you holding in your hand there, by the way? Are you going to reveal it?
Okay,
there we go.
This is what I write in every day.
I love it.
And I also write letters.
Amazing.
Got a couple of letters.
They still do that.
I do Polaroids. These are from the Fuji Instax Square that I got, which is amazing because you can punch images out of your phone or whatever else you shoot with. Whatever camera goes to the phone goes to the Fuji Instax printer, which is really nice. I'm going to use that for my workshop coming up.
Nice.
Step number one is to take a deep breath. That is point number one. Take a deep breath and remember, this is supposed to be fun. I have seen so many people go down the rabbit hole of turning, of basically making bookmaking into some absolutely stressful endeavor where they feel like they're being judged and everything is on the line. And a lot of people who've never made a book before or never made prints before put this insane amount of pressure on themselves to try to produce something perfect the first time they sit down to try to make something. And I think making a perfect book is basically unrealistic for anyone, let alone somebody who's just getting started making prints or making books. I mean, if you just look at material choices alone, let's say that you want to make inkjet prints. If you just look at material choices alone, whether it's inkjet papers, surfaces, weights, what printer are you going to use? What size are you going to print? All of those things can be completely overwhelming. So just take a deep breath and realize, of all the stuff that we have to do as human beings on a daily basis, whether it's deal with COVID or pay taxes or whatever it is, that's the kind of stuff that you get stressed about. Making prints and making books and magazines should be fun. And it's just something to keep in mind. It's a mindset, because I've run into many photographers over the years who basically have alienated themselves and really made everyone around them miserable because of their obsession over putting something into print. And yes, printing is important. I think it's what I would call going full circle with your work, is going from concept to capture to print. I think that's sort of a logical circle as a photographer. But most of the people around you are not going to care at that level. And so you just have to keep it in perspective.
I like that.
Take a deep breath. And I think the secondary part of this is that bookmaking or printmaking is a separate language that contains many different dialects. And if you just take bookmaking, for example, you've got your editing, your sequencing, your page design, your typography, your material choices, your trim size, your volume that you're going to print in, your printing technology, whether it's POD or offset. You have all of those decisions, and each one of those categories is a separate dialect. So you might speak English, but I don't speak like the same English that the Irish speak or the folks in Britain speak. We have different accents, different dialects. We use different terminology. And so each one of those categories, like for me, I studied photojournalism. I got a degree in photography, but I had no design training whatsoever. So when I started to make prints and make books, I was catching up, because I was like, I don't know anything about typography. I don't know anything about page design. I don't know about book materials or paper types or end sheets or any of that stuff. So I had to take my time and learn it. And I think that underlying concept of just taking a deep breath and saying, look, I need to just enjoy the process of learning all these things and keep the process fun, because happy bookmakers tend to make good books. Unhappy, stressed out bookmakers tend to make things that don't live up to their expectations. And then it makes it worse for everyone, because then we all know what that's like. You kind of miss on something and then you spend the next 4 weeks online complaining about it. We all do it, people. Don't deny it. We've all been there.
Yeah. Happy bookmakers. That's what we want. I love it.
Yes.
Printmakers.
All right. Are you ready? Are you ready for point two?
I am.
Point two is also out in front of the process. Point two is the DAM point, the digital asset management. So one of the questions I've had 1,000 times in the last 10 years is how on earth can you make so many books? I've made 240 books with Blurb alone.
Dang.
That doesn't include MagCloud. It doesn't include all the other companies that I've used. 240 with Blurb. I'm not saying those are all good books, not by a long shot, but I made them all. And I give the same answer every time someone asks that. And the answer is because I have a system in place. And the system starts with good digital asset management, which in layman's terms means where the heck are my images? How do I find them? And how do I retrieve them to put in a book? And so your digital asset management system has to be in place. Whatever path you choose to go with digital asset, that could be using Capture One, it could be Lightroom, it could be Photoshop, whatever system you have, LumaFusion or whatever else is out there. You have to determine your system and stick with it. So when the time comes to make a book, you are not searching for images. You are not having to tweak those images. You are not having to export or do anything because the images are already ready to go.
Yeah.
I would say that is a third of the battle. I would say at least a third of the people that I encounter who have trouble that said, I haven't been able to pull off the book thing yet, is because they don't have a handle on where their images are. And so when I go to make a book, what I do is when I import images into Lightroom, I make my edit, and we're going to get to editing in a minute. I am merciless when it comes to the edit. There is no fat in my edit. There's no extraneous stuff. So I know how to edit, and then those images are labeled and they are tweaked, and they are exported ready to go to print so that when I get a moment to make a book, I don't have to do any of that. All I have to do is import those images and I start building the book.
Dan,
Peter Crow.
Let me ask you two things. So it's important differentiation between editing and processing, first of all.
Oh, yeah.
So you're talking about editing, which means?
So I'm going to get to editing in a minute. That's my...
Okay.
That is my third point.
Okay, cool. So we'll get to that. But you brought up something, labeling. How do you label those images? Do you actually change the file name?
The handling of files, there are literally dozens and dozens of ways of doing this. And everybody has a system. And I wouldn't say that one system is better than the other. It's just whatever system that you happen to settle on, you want to maintain it so that you have a routine in place and that the digital asset management doesn't become an obstacle. It just becomes part of the process.
Yeah.
So what I do is I do not throw any images away ever. I keep every single frame that I shoot, because when you go to make books, oftentimes you're going back to those collections of images and you're pulling things that you didn't initially think you would need. So throwing away images to me is an amateur hour methodology. I don't know good professionals that throw work away, because and there are famous stories through photographic history of photographers who didn't throw things away, who ended up basically finding career-changing, life-changing imagery because they didn't throw things away. Dirk Halstead is a name that comes to mind. If you want to look up that story, it's a pretty incredible story about the Monica Lewinsky scandal. And he remembered seeing her face, didn't know who she was, hired a researcher, went back through his archive of transparencies and found the image of that situation, which of course was that image is probably sold hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars worth of sales for that one single image. That's what you get for not throwing your stuff away. So I don't throw anything away. What I do is I go through and I make a very basic assessment. And I label 1-star the images that I think are going to be selects or edits. Mm-hmm. I am very, very careful about my starring system. Maybe once or twice a year, maybe I would have a 5-star image, but most of the time everything is down in the 1-star, 2-star range. And then those images are, the file name is, I have my own labeling system for the file name. And again, there's a million ways to do that. And then those images are exported out into the size that I would need for making the publication that I want. And that has the editing is a whole separate thing. And that's what point three here is understanding whether you're making a single print or a book or publication, is your edit is, is the key to the whole thing. Basically, I would say it's probably the single most important factor is the edit of what you pull. The sequence would be the secondary part of that in terms of what order you put those images in. But editing is an art form. And I think what's happened, and I saw this going back to the late 90s when digital technology began to arrive, is I saw an almost immediate erosion of editing ability. Whereas during the film era, when you put transparencies on a light box, you knew immediately whether an image worked or not. And when people edited, you know, we had full-time picture editors that we were working with on a regular basis. If you did an assignment, most often you were partnered with a full-time picture editor that would help make sense of what it is that you were making. And when digital came along, most of those people either started to begin getting laid off or they were aging out and they weren't being replaced. And so you saw this erosion of editing skills. And the tricky part is digital is an amazing thing. But like I can take this camera this afternoon and I have basically an endless amount of imagery that I can make. And for some weird reason, that has been touted as being a good thing, that you can go into the field and shoot 10,000 photographs. And that is a terrible idea. Editing is really where you're in control of who you are as a photographer. If you're a good photographer, there is no reason to shoot 10,000 frames in the field because there are simply not that many good moments happening around you. So you shoot tight in the field. And then when it comes to editing for your images or your publication, I think the easiest thing to do is to start with something like, what are the top 25 images? And then what are the best 10? What are the single best 5 images? And then what is the single most important image from a shoot? That is editing. So if you shoot 1,000 images and you cull it to 500, that's not editing.
Yeah.
That is just, you know, that's sloppiness that doesn't apply because, okay, now you have 500 images. If you're going to make a single print, now what are you going to do? So it's really, and I was fortunate because when I came up in photography and I was working in the newspapers, typically a newspaper would only run a single image from a story. Occasionally you get lucky, they would do a picture package, maybe 3 or 4 images total. But most of the time it was like, hey, every single day under pressure and deadline, you had to determine what the single most important image was. And that is a whole separate skill. And if you don't have it, it just takes practice. You know, it takes throwing things down, making small prints, putting them on a table, and then editing and figuring out what works best together. It's actually a really fun part of the process. So editing would be number 3. The tighter you edit, the better it's going to be. If you've got great work, give it space in the publication and let it breathe. You don't need 20 pictures when one picture is going to tell the same story. And again, that's really about practice. When you shoot images every day, year after year, and you're forced to edit those daily, year after year, it's when you get good. Editing is just like photography or basketball, for that matter. It's a skill that requires practice to get better.
Please subscribe and enable the bell so you don't miss any of our new shows. Like the video and please share it and leave your comments. I love hearing from you. And remember to get out and capture your own images of life.